Let's start a simple thing, stress. Now, if you see stress is something, you know, you cannot bear, you know, something beyond the expectations, you expect something and you get something, and that frustration gap is nothing but the stress. So we can get the stress because of time problem, reaching here on time, starting the work on time, lot of work. Now that football is going on, World Cup. So whether you're playing or not playing, still if you're supporting one team and last 3 minutes are there, it could be a stressful situation. So stress is something, you know, abnormal, and that we want to deal with. Now the good part of this course is that I'm going to correlate the stress with the body. And what I believe is that what God has created is probably answer of everything in our own body. So if you can correlate the stress with our body, the stress engineering, many of the answers can be given. So not each and every time, but as and when it comes, I would like to give the real life, you know, examples. Some examples will be directly analytical and theoretical. Some will not correlate, but easy to understand. Fine. So that is something unusual what you have. That is nothing but the stress. Now all of us are from the piping industry, so we know that, you know, physics is one of our basic topic in the engineering. So if you see this, everything is like a kind of atomic structure. When you take any of the material, it is made up of molecules and atoms, right? When you have the molecules and atom, you can see that they are closely bounded each other. They have got a force which actually attracts each other, which keep them bonding. The force is very strong in solids. The force is a little weaker in liquid, and it is the weakest in the gases, right? Now, what happens? Let's see, you know, what is exactly the stress. Now, let's consider that you are traveling in a local train, okay? In India, the population is too much, so local trains are always flooded. There is a train which is full of crowd and you are one of them. Now what happens if somebody, you know, gets into the train, okay, when the same body gets into the train at some particular station, he exerts some force. Now without telling each other, automatically you give one component of the force against him. So you do not allow him to get in the train very easily. Had it been like that, he would have, you know, just walked in. But he has to push through, right? So he is pushing you, he is giving some force, and you are resisting it. And that resistance is called as stress. Okay? So that resistance is called as stress. So whenever you apply force, the resistance gets developed, and that is nothing but a law of inertia. Nobody wants to change. If I say that tomorrow let's have the same session at 6 o'clock in the morning, half of you will say no, not possible, probably including me, no. And you know, inertia is biggest enemy, okay, for the success. Fine. So if I consider this, now I just ask a simple question. This is a wall, you know, nice wall. I just put a force onto it. Can you see any displacement? Do you expect that displacement is taking place? No, there is no displacement. This is the practical answer. But if I try to correlate this, probably a very simple thing you know in your day-to-day life, the first thing what we learn in the engineering is it not a stress-strain curve? Something like this. We write stress here, and we line strain here. Fine? Now, can I say mathematically, you know what is stress formula? Probably all of us to know that. It is nothing but something force upon area, right? So can I say it force upon area? And strain, what we know is that you take any body, yeah? You apply a force, it will elongate, and when you release it, it will come back. So, yeah, so that extra extension, if you compare with the original one, you get the strain, and we write as delta L upon L. Now let's assume that this experiment is being done on a simple specimen. Now I am applying a force. Now what is happening because of this force? because of this force, there is some extension, right? Now this is my delta L. This is my L length. Fine. Now what we are doing is that we are actually comparing this with this. Now there are some assumptions actually, you know. If you take this finite 3 to 4 sections of it, every time when I reach here, I can compare with this original length. When I reach to the second point, should I not compare with the original plus this? Because I am traveling from this point to this point. The third time when I travel, I am traveling from this point to this point. So my original length, is it not changing? Every time it's changing, right? But what our assumption is that in the normal pipe stress analysis, we consider that this L is constant. We don't keep on changing it. Okay. Now, typically this area, now you know that if I take probably a rubber and if I just pull it, what's going to happen? The rubber is going to get squeezed laterally. Fine. Now that squeezing of the rubber, same way, if you keep on pulling it, is it not after some time there will be a neck formation? Now when there is a neck formation, the material is squeezing, is it not the area is also changing? Every time it's changing, right? So that's the reason this is changing every time. But I am not doing this analysis for each and every area. My assumption becomes whatever area I had, that is constant. Okay, and that's the reason the stress strain curve looks like this. If you consider this, this is probably the experiment anyone or probably all of us might have done in our college days, that we have taken one wire, put the weight below it, and what happens is that when you extend it, we wanted to find out the Young's modulus. You remember that, right? So same experiment I am doing, I am trying to find out the say Young's modulus out of it. What's happening? Everything is squeezing. So every time the area is getting smaller. And when this fails elastically, what will be the area here? When it fails on the time of failing, zero, tending to zero. Now if it is tending to zero, then if the area tends to zero here, what should be the stress? Tending to infinity, right? So can I say that when the material actually fails, the capacity is almost infinite? This is called equivalent stress, not the real stress. Otherwise each material should have capacity of ultimate tensile strength should have been where? Infinity. So if you do not consider that the area is changing, no, I want to do it like this, and if the L, probably your stress strength curve will go something here up. This is called true stress strength curve, the reality, and this is what we analyze. Why? Because our assumptions are area is constant and length is constant. Based on that we go. Fine. Now my question was, if I apply a force, is there any displacement? And then we said no, there is no displacement when the force is there. Can I zoom this up? Now I am zooming this up. If you see this, is it not starting with the origin 0, 0? Starting with the origin 0, 0. Now, as I said, the area is constant. Can I just write force here? Let's say area is constant. I know that length is constant. So shall I say deformation delta L? So is it not the same curve of force and displacement? And if you remember, we, you know, talked something about energy stored in the body as an elastic energy. Fine. This is the energy stored in the body. When you apply any force, right, there is a law of conservation of energy, right? Energy can neither be created nor be destroyed. Now in this case, what is happening? Whenever you apply a force, it has to get stored somewhere as an elastic energy. So this is that energy. Now if I ask you, a very small amount of force, very small, this much, very small, right? Even though this force in some 0.0001 newton, very small, If I leave this line in y-axis up, so definitely I should have a point correspondingly here. And if I have the point correspondingly here, if I drop it down, don't you think there has to be some very small displacement? Very small, right? So practically, yes, I cannot see anything. But theoretically, there has to be a displacement, because without that, nothing can happen. So the first step of engineering is nothing but the displacement. When you apply a force, there has to be a displacement. Do you agree? Right? And what happens in college, we are being trained first what? When you learn the stress and strain, right? What did you learn first? Stress or strength? Stress. So we were taught stress first, but stress is not the first. Stress comes later. Displacement comes first, right? So can I write that when I start anything, the displacement field is the one which will come into picture. First is displacement field. Fine. So whenever a force is applied, there has to be a displacement. Whether you can see it or not, that is your problem. It has to be there. As a concept, it is fictitious. It's not the exactly a real engineering definition or real engineering statement. Why I am saying so? Because if I ask you, in college, probably you might have had a measurements and control subject or something, you know, you might have learned some measurements. In that, you have learned all those SI units, MKS units, you know, blah, blah, blah. In that, you might have learned something called strain gauges. Strain gauges, right? If you want to understand any displacement, okay, the word is called strain gauge. Have you ever time heard of a word called stress gauge? That go there and check a stress? You cannot. So you cannot go and measure the stress. Absolutely stress you cannot measure, because stress is a state, okay, which keeps on changing. It's not like when the stress is 5000 psi, everywhere it is 5000 psi. No, it's not like this. It keeps on changing. If I come back to the example that you are in a train standing there, wherever you stand, based on that position, you are actually experiencing the force, don't you? If you are sitting in a chair very relaxingly, you probably have the stress of your own weight only. If you are standing on the door and everybody is trying to push you out of the door, you feel the different kind of force. Your resistance is more. Fine. If you are mid of the crowd, everybody is pushing, then you need not hold anywhere, because everybody is, you know, holding you very well. You can have your mobile and have a chatting, no issues, because you care nothing. It's like an aeroplane travel, because you cannot go here, you cannot go there, you cannot go here, you cannot go back. Everybody is surrounding you. Fine. So that is called state of stress. So stress cannot be defined only by saying, oh, this is like 5000 psi, 3000 psi. No, not like this. Fine. Now, since we have come to this, can I ask you a question? Whether the stress is a scalar or a vector? Which has got, which has the magnitude, but which does not have the direction. Example? Yeah. I would say a simple example. Can I give length? 5 centimeter, or probably this could be 15 centimeter length. You measure from here or you measure from here, it is going to be 15 centimeter. So when I say draw 15 centimeter, then you can draw it and it will be always 15 centimeter. But if I say that apply a force of say 10 newton on this bottle, now can you tell me whether the water is going to get lifted up or it will remain as it is? If I say just apply a force of 10 newton, what will happen? No, then you will be asking me a question, whether it's upward or downward. If I say upward force, then I will lift it. If it is a downward, I cannot. Right? Fine. So force is a vector, right? Force becomes a vector. Now we are talking something about force. What is area? Area is a scalar or vector? Scalar. You understood scalar means what? Only the dimensions No direction. So if I say this a board is like 3 feet by 2 feet, you keep it like this or you keep it like this, it is 3 feet by 2 feet, area will remain the same. Now it's a vector, it's a scalar, so the product will be vector, the product will be vector, fine. So minimum stress is a vector. It is one step ahead of that, we will see that, okay. It is one step ahead of that, we will see. We were talking about this. So this is my displacement field which I am talking about. When I apply a force, definitely there will be a displacement. So displacement is must. Gone? Fine. So this becomes the first one. So as soon as I apply a force, I get some value called delta L. Now this is measurable. You can measure probably a length of an atom as well nowadays, right? Centimeter, millimeter, microns, all. You can measure it. So this is a measurable quantity. So I can measure the deflections, I can measure the deformations. Now what I do is that I compare it against my original length, and that is what I call as a strain. So once I know the displacement, this is measurable, the second term comes is a strain field. See, I am using the word called field. Why? Because you always have to imagine that I am a part of that local train. So it's a field. Okay. So I'm surrounded by all the, you know, forces like this. So the strain field is the next term which will come. And the last, once this is done, for our mathematical evaluation, we derive something called stress. How? That we will see later. Now, the third will be coming, the stress field. If I take a random shape, probably what I can say, something like this, a random shape, okay. Now don't you think it will be acted upon by so many forces, various forces, right? It will be acted upon by various forces. Like your same example, you are in a train, the forces will be exerted by everywhere. So if you want to study it, then you actually have to study each and every force. It will be very much difficult. I cannot study the force, very difficult. So what we have done for the simplicity, we have defined the three-axis system. We have defined the three-axis system, something x-axis, something y-axis, something z-axis, right? And now we are thinking. Now since we will be dealing with the pipe, so let's go with the pipe, so that it will be very easy to understand. Now this is the pipe. Now I want to study this pipe. And what I have done for simplicity, I am going with one axis along the length. These axes are called as longitudinal axis. Fine. Then there will be another axis. Can I call it the radial? And the third one, this is called as circumferential. These are my three axes. So what I am trying to do is that I am trying to have the pipe. I want to study the pipe now, because the pipe is actually experiencing probably forces from all everywhere. So how to study it? So let's divide into a three-part system. And these are called as principal axis. Principal means what? Main axis. Fine. Now, you know how the engineering is done. It is very simple. We think that stress is something like force upon area, and strain is something like delta L upon L. And that is the reason, if I say, if I know the force and the area, the stress is known to me. See, engineering is not done like this. How these formulas have come and everything. Everything has got experimental background. I take a simple example. You are coughing for a long time. You go to a doctor, he gives you some medicine. Fine. After 2 days, the cough is not cured, you are still coughing. He gives something little bit heavy dose. Then also you are not good. Then he says that go and do the blood test. Right? Then you go and check your blood, and then he finds in the blood test your some XYZ number of cells have gone beyond the limit. Have you seen your blood report anytime? Say for example, hemoglobin, right? You will be having something 13.5 and 14. Then the male range is something 10 to 15, like this. And you are following something 13. So he says, okay, XYZ kind of cell, white cells, red cells. What they have done? They have tested thousands or lakhs number of healthy people, and they have found out what is the hemoglobin level in each one of them. When you are not well, they are comparing that with those statistical data. Is it not same the way we have used something design data book, wherein some strength values were given to us, yield strength, ultimate tensile strength, we will be talking on that, right? So engineering is like that. What we do is that we compare these stress values with already tested specimen. So what is the real engineering, where the people are doing PhDs and all, they are doing it here on the specimen. They take a specimen, they force it, they take the measurements, and then they say that if this material has got, this is the capacity. They will be measuring this continuously, and they will be saying when the yield has started, the strain value was this much, or the shear stress was this much. And what you do when you are checking this, you compare a stress value here and for the same material, what was done experimentally. When these two values match, you can predict that yes, this can fail or this can survive. Definitely, when you are doing the experiments, it is something like everything is, you know, good and under observation. So you need not have a factor of safety. But when you are doing something like this, when the plant is being erected, you have to have a factor of safety. So what we do is that the testing multiply by some factor of safety, which is definitely, if you are multiplying it, it is less than 1. If you are dividing it, it will be more than 1. So you will be having some less capacity for the design, and these are called as the allowable stresses, allowable values. Okay. So what I am going to do is that the experiments will be carried out. I will be getting some values and I am going to check it. Now these are my 3-axis system. Fine. So to start with, this is my 3-axis system, if you have seen X, Y, Z. And if you see this, if you want to define the stress, it is a big matrix. Every time you get a force coming out, which is given as a normal force, sigma XX. Every time you have got a force which is along, which is called shear, we will see what do you mean by shear. And you have got the other force. So every time there is a force. Now, you know, have you seen this here? Can I ask, if I apply some force in this direction, if I apply force in this direction on this pipe, what will be the stress at this point in between? What will be the stress? Say I know the force is something 100 Newton, fine, and say this small area is 1 centimeter square. What will be the stress force upon 100? Now look at it. First of all, little bit trick. Do you have a material exist here? Do you have a material there? No. You don't have a material. So if there is no material, there cannot be a stress. Right? It cannot be. So the question itself is wrong. You cannot have a stress at this point. Fine? Now, yeah, the stress could be here. Now, you know, this axis, when you're imagining, every book shows the axis like this, but you should not imagine like this. What you should imagine is, this is very important. You have to imagine this 3D box here. So if I zoom this, I should imagine that there is some brick. And the funniest part is, you know, when you're actually doing the detailed stress analysis, this is something like a dimensionless box. You have to imagine, and that is the reason I am calling it as a state of stress. So you need to imagine a box which is having some normal component in excess, what we call as a stress, normal stress, some component in shear, what we call as a tau, some in this circumferential. So these, don't you think these also has the same axis, X, Y and Z? So these are called global axis, I would say. Global in the sense what? You take any point You just shift the axis there. And that is the way you should think about the stress. Now, this gives me the various kind of stresses. For example, one is called tensile one. You all know that. So, if I take this, suppose this is a metallic body. Always imagine metallic, because polymers behave in a different way. So, if I pull this, the stress is going to get here, that is called tensile. If I compress it, push it today together, this is nothing but compressive stress, right? If you take a anything, like, you know that there is lattice structure, and it is all atoms are like a crystal structure, what we call as, fine. When you apply force, there are, you know, various planes available. Like, for example, a person gets into a crowded train. If he is a very regular person who travels by the train, he knows that how to get very inside and secure his place. So, very easily he travels through. He knows who is the weaker person, so he push him away, he goes in. If the stronger one, he doesn't go there, he takes another route. So, there are various planes available. So, typically in this as well, we have got various planes available, various planes, right? And when you apply force, if you remember this, there is a neck formation. This is what we are talking about, the elastic material, fine, elastic material. So, what is going to happen in that case, this shape, how this shape has achieved, how, why the neck has formed, what has happened, what is happening there when the neck is forming? Don't you think one layer is sliding on the another layer, the next is further sliding on the another layer, further sliding, and that is the way they are getting narrower, 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 narrower. Otherwise, if that wouldn't have had happened, it should have been a brittle failure, no? Very fast, cut. All the surface, entire surface getting away from each other at a single go. It's not happening. What is happening? It is getting narrower, 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 narrower. So, what is that process is? It's nothing but sliding one layer on another, fine. So, shear is that component. Now, in our piping industry or a process industry, we do not use brittle materials except for some casting fabrications. What we do, probably a pump casing, therein you can have a low carbon steels or like mild steels or some steels which can be brittle, but your all grades of steel A106, A53, all are elastic. What is elastic, that we will definitely discuss later, fine, when we go to that topic. Okay, so we were talking about that. So, shear is nothing but, now if I ask you a question, when this experiment is going on, I am pulling it down, do you think will it be having a shear in this experiment? If I put a force of say 100 newtons here and it is fixed at top, will it be having shear on top? Or anywhere in the body, yeah. Somewhere, yes. Yeah, why? Because, you know, there could be various planes which you don't know. So, right now, if somebody says that there is no shear, then he is thinking only about one plane, and that plane is this plane. If he is thinking only about one plane and if the force is applied, then yes, there is no shear, it's all normal. But if somebody is thinking about this plane, what's going to happen if I just take this here? This is my plane. Now, my force is applied like this. This is my force, 100 newtons. So, can I split this force as one along the axis and one perpendicular to the axis? So, can I say this is a normal component? And can I say this is a shear component? Fine. Now, if I ask you a question, if material is failing, or any material, will it fail more likely because of the normal force, or will it fail more likely because of shear? Shear. Why? Because if I ask you simple thing, this is the table, right? If I ask you, take this table outside of this room, take this table outside of this room, you have got two options. One is you lift it and take it out, or else if I allow you to slide it, you can slide it and take it out. what you will do? Slide it, right? Because pushing is more, I would say it's easier. The way the responsibilities, we try to push it. Pushing is easy, no? My responsibility, you take it. You take it. Fine. So pushing is more easy. So shear failures are predominant, and that's the reason we use the theories called maximum shear stress theory. So what we are doing, you know, whatever shear stress is present when the experiment was tested in the lab, when in reality, if the shear stress reached to that value, we will say that it will fail. And this is nothing but the shear stress theory, simple. Like the medical science, if your particular cells are going beyond the limit, you have that disease. A person can fail. So the doctor tries to bring it back to the normal level, probably like a blood pressure, they try to bring it back. Typically a stress engineer, what he does some change in the layout, sometimes he adds the supports and he brings the stress back within the limit. We had this simple experiment wherein we designed the bolt for a load. Say this, there are two plates and I am giving a force of say 100 newtons, and say this area, if I am supposed to find out the area here, then this is a two mark question for us. Then how do you find out the area for the bolt? What is the first step we will be doing? First step is to ask a question, what kind of failure it is? What is the failure? Which failure the bolt will experience? In this case, shear failure, yes. So first question is what? Type of failure? Right? So I said it's a shear. What is the second step? Calculate the shear stress developed. Fine. So for that condition, I can start with the assumption that let's assume that this is 10 centimeter square area. Okay. Or else I can say 10 centimeter as a diameter. Let's take one random value. So what's going to happen? Or I take 10 millimeter, 10 centimeter is too much. Then can I say shear stress is force upon area? The force acting is 100 newtons divided by pi by 4 into say 10 square. Now whatever answer comes, the answer will be 4 by pi, because 100 will get cancelled, 4 will go up, so stress value becomes 4 by pi. It will be something 1.1 or something newton per mm square. This is my second step, right? So I got the stress value. Now next what I do, I go and open the standards of materials, right? Material standards. Therein I find the shear stress capacity of this material, I would say is 3 newton per mm square. Shear stress capacity is say 3 newton per mm square. Now I compare this. Now first of all, how I get the shear stress capacity? There are rules for that as well. If you know the yield strength, what is the yield? If you remember when this neck formation starts in stress strain curve, that is what we call as a yielded, right? Perfect. So what's happening? 4 upon pi. So this is my yield stress, sorry, the shear stress. If this less than this, then can I say the design is safe? If not, if it has got value of 0.5 or 0.8, then what I will do? I can change force, but can I? Piping, we don't change the diameter, okay? So we do some other things. We add some supports or we add some flexibility by which we try to reduce the force. Okay, that is what we do. Second step. Now, this is done by the computer in the large scale. This is all analysis. That is the reason we need computer, because right now it's a simple problem. If I give you a complex system, then you cannot do it, right? This is done by computer. Now, who is this allowable value? Can I say this is the allowable value? Allayable stress?
Yes.
Now, who gives this? The person who has tested it? Some body, ASTM. So, this is given by code. So, code gives this, and that is what we call as allayable stress. And what? Computer has got the database of all these values. So, you select the material, you select the temperature, and these values get automatically selected by the computer. Computer does this. Who gives the formula? That shear stress, the formula has to be F upon A. The formula also is given by code. Which formula to be used? This is also by code. Definitely, this is the formula is given by the basic engineering, but code is selecting the formulas. Code is even modifying the formulas as well. And that is the reason different code have different formula, because they have concentrated on different parts, like 31.1 power piping, little bit difference in formula, 31.3 little bit difference, pipeline codes 31.4 and 8, they are not thinking much about dead weight. Why they are not thinking about dead weights much? Because the pipeline is laid on the ground. So for them, don't you think you are relaxed when you are sleeping? Why you feel relaxed when you are sleeping? Because you get infinite number of supports. So your spine says, I need not take your body weight, your leg says, I need not take it. Right? So when the pipeline is laid, pipeline has infinite number of support. Why then they should talk about the stress because of loads or forces? They won't. That's why that code doesn't talk about it unless until the line comes above ground. So buried pipe, weight driven stresses doesn't matter. There the pressure driven and the temperature driven stresses will come into picture. Fine. So this is also the various formulas by the code. Computer does these things, and then we get whether design is safe or not. So you got the three steps, right? Kind of. Then the first is identify the failure, second is calculate it, and the third step is compare it, safe or not. Fine. This is the simplest way any software works in the engineering. When this is a pipe, I would say I am going to use it for both to explain you the expansion joint called bellows as well as even the pipe. So even though this is actually, you can put it right now, consider it as a normal pipe. So when I bend the pipe, what kind of stresses will get developed? Tensile or compressive?
Tensile.
Both. Yes, upper ki taraf tensile, the upper part is tensile, the lower part is compressive, hence both the things are important to me. Fine. Now this is because of, now am I not applying a force onto it, mechanical force? Fine. So there is no temperature present right now. So right now, is it not like tension and compression both are in picture because of weight? Fine. So that is the reason the code talks about both the compressive as well as tensile. And what allayable stress, when you try to find out, you should take the minimum of these two, minimum of compressive and minimum of tensile as your allayable stress value. Okay, so that's the way. In case of elastic steel, always the stress value in tension is little lower, and that's the reason we do all the testing as universal tensile test machines. So this is weaker here. So we test it in tension and we take tension only, and that's the reason in the code, if you read it, you will find it as ultimate tensile strength, UTS, what they give. Right? So this is my bending which comes into picture. I know the tension, I know the compression, I know the bending. Even if I try to twist it, twisting, what's going to happen? Which kind of stress will come into picture? If you try to twist your hand, what is happening when you twist your hand? Can you see? If you want to open this, one way of opening is push it or pull it out. Second is twisting it. What we do? Twist. Even though you don't have this kind of, you know, arcs or something, even if I just weld it, then also this is difficult. What is happening? Which kind of failure it is? Shear? Yes. So when I am twisting, the failure comes is shear. Okay, so whenever you give any torque, shear is the failure which is predominant. Now, Here, if you see this assumption, which we have little now seen, actually speaking, the stress will keep on changing. It will be maximum in the line of action, and as you go away, it will be little bit less. But what we understand or what we assume, that it's the average stress. Average stress in the sense, we consider the area is constant, so force upon area, so whatever stress comes. We do not do this micro level analysis in pipe stress. That's the reason I go with the average stress. I have this as say vessel, a simple vessel which is supported here. I am taking a line which is going to the pump. There is a valve, there is a strainer, and say there is a pump here. I want to do the analysis of the system. Fine. Now first, what we studied first, if you want to do the analysis, first you should identify the type of failures. You should define the problem. So let's define the problem. Now tell me, what is the problem and what problems can come? I cannot say as long as I do not know what is the fluid inside. If I have a fluid which is like a density very high, like mercury probably, 13 times dense than the water, if it is full of mercury, it will be in tons of weight. What if this valve is with an actuator? What will happen? A big actuator on top of this. Can it fail? Yes, it can fail. So the first thing of failure can be because of weight. So is it not the weight is the first culprit which can be damaging it? Fine. Now the second culprit can be pressure. If you pressurize this to an extent that it cannot take it, what will happen? It will burst. So pressure, I should know that. What could be the third culprit? Temperature. Yeah, if you heat this to 300-400 degrees Celsius, is it not going to expand? And when the pipe wants to expand, the pump says, I am fixed. Equipment is also fixed. Then the temperature becomes. Then, by chance, this is a two-phase system. Slug formation. Could be a water hammer problem. Probably suction will not have, but discharge can have. Okay. So there could be the problem like a vibrations. What if this is in the area of earthquake?
Seismic.
What if the line size is say 20 inch and exposed to the very high speed wind? It will create the problems. So we need to take wind. Fine. So weight, pressure, temperatures, vibrations, earthquakes, wind, sometimes relief wall pops up. Okay. By chance, this is not a good soil and the pump settles down. Then the settlement can be an issue. So can I say settlement becomes an issue? When you are thinking about a weight, commodity weight, pipe weight, snowka weight, even in Gulf countries, you have to even take care of sand weights. Sand ka storm aa gaya. Sometimes if the line is buried and the truck is going to pass over it, that weight, it can come. Okay, so all kind of weights, valve with the actuator, so all the weights, you should ignore nothing. Only thing is that in a general pipe stress analysis, we ignore some weights of pressure indicators and temperature indicators, small piping. Okay, but otherwise we should consider all the weights. But these weights also you cannot ignore if you are doing the dynamic stress analysis. Because dynamic stress analysis, the heart is the weight, the thickness, the Young's modulus, the supporting span. So if that goes wrong, then the dynamic goes wrong. Okay, fine. So this is the weight. When I say pressure, which kind of pressure I am going to check? Internal pressure, operating pressure, the design pressure as well, right? Any other pressure? Hydro test pressure. Fine to, you know, atmospheric pressure can be catastrophic. If I take a tin of any soft drink, okay, if I just empty it, very small tin, and if I put some cotton into it and I make a fire, you know, I make the cotton burn, and if I close it down, what will happen? Squeezing action. Why? Because the 20% oxygen will be taken care by that burning activity. So you have got a vacuum equal to 20% inside, and when you have something from outside, it will squeeze. So when you are doing the duct piping, HVAC ducts or any duct, those ducts, you have to design them for vacuum, for buckling, okay? And the guideline for that is, when the D by T ratio is more than 100, okay, diameter to thickness ratio, if it crosses the 100, it's better to go with these kind of analysis, okay? One more question. What could be the maximum vacuum a pipe can have? I'm taking out the air from here. Now, for example, I want to make a vacuum here. If I put a pump there, who is sucking it? I ask a reverse question. If I want to pressurize this system, up to what pressure I can go? I want to pressurize this room, add the pressure. I can go whatever extent I want. I just will go on keeping the air in, 1 bar, 2 bar, 3 bar, 10 bar, 100 bar, 1000 bar. One find of time it will burst. This room will burst. I want to create a vacuum. What vacuum I can create? I will take out the air. It's like I have got, say, $100 in my pocket. How much you can take from me if you rob me? Why you cannot take $1,000 from me? Because I don't have it, right? Typically, what is the pressure right now here in absolute? 1 bar. Difference in absolute and gauge. Right now, the pressure is 1 bar absolute. That is 0 bar gauge. Because if I put a gauge here, it will show me the gauge 0. Now, if I want to take the air out of it, how much air I can take? Only 1 bar. Whatever present, that only I can take out. So what extreme I can go is a full vacuum. So 0 bar absolute is the value of vacuum I can have. I cannot go below than that. So that is the pressure. But in 31.3, when we deal the code, which we will be talking mainly, we will be discussing considering the internal pressures. Okay. For vacuum design, you can refer ASME section 8. Therein the formulas are given. Even 31.3 refers that code. Okay. So pressure is given, this is given, then the temperature. Now, when I say temperature, what kind of temperature I need to consider? First is operating temperature, design temperature, what else?
Ambient
conditions as well. But because consider this, probably the Gulf, the daytime temperature reaches to plus 40, plus 50. Night time it could be very low, 10 degree as well. In winter season it can go to 0 degree as well, probably Norway kind of countries, sub-zero temperature is also possible. So we do not know at what temperature the pipe is going to get installed. If it is installed as 21 degree plus, and one point of time it goes minus 30 degree atmospherically, or minus 10 degree for that matter, what's going to happen? The pipe is going to get compressed. So who will take care of that at that time? Hence ambient conditions required. So we cannot. So code is very much clear. When you are doing a stress analysis, you should be having the maximum range of the temperature covered for the analysis. Okay, that's sure. One more thing comes, that is called as a steam out conditions sometime. Okay, so you have a plant which running at 100 degree design, for that matter this is 100 degree design, but there are chances that this can go in steam out condition as 200 degree, because it is not possible in a plant that different steams can be made available at different locations. I want to clean the plant. So what I do, I have got one boiler. I will take the line from the boiler and I will purge everywhere. So the temperature can go up to 200 degree here. Fine, this is possible. Now we need to check that for this 200 degree Celsius, pump will not be working. we won't make the pump work, no? Probably the valve, it will be blinded here, but the pipe can experience, right? So at least the stresses in the pipe corresponding to 200 steam out condition, we must see. Something comes like a vibration, which comes under the dynamic, that the system can vibrate, and we need to check the frequency should not match with the natural frequency of the system, otherwise there could be resonance. Earthquake can come. What's going to happen because of earthquake? It's going to get shaken. Now, if I put it on the paper and if I start shaking this, now what's going to happen? There will be the forces which will go here, again it will come back, again here, again. So, very simplistic. If you are traveling in a train, you are standing, the train is just halted at a station. Now, the train starts, you get a jerk. Now, if the train motorman keeps on changing his speed, start stop, what you will keep on doing? Like this, here and there. What you will do ultimately? You will hold somewhere. That is what we do. We hold the system in case of winds and earthquake. If the strong wind comes like a cyclone, what you will do first? Either you will go under the shelter. If you cannot go, you will hold somewhere. So we need to hold the pipe as well. And that is the reason in piping system we give the guides. We have got the supports, right? The rest supports, the guiding supports, the U-bolts, the clamps. Fine. And then definitely there are issues like a displacement or settlement. If this goes down, what to do? Okay. So that these are the reasons of the stresses. So we will see them one by one. Why I'm doing this analysis? What it is, why it is required to be done? First of all, my intention is what? Safety of the plant. That is the first intention what I do the analysis. Now, how I do ensure that the plant is safe? We have seen that example little while earlier wherein we were talking about the bolt design. We calculate the stress. Now, we compared against the actual material database, and that material database is given in the code. So, what we are supposed to do is that when you check the stresses, the second objective is in order to keep the nozzle loads within the allowable limit. Now, if you look at here, one is that the stress point of view, the forces exerted on this nozzle are also important. See this. Now, this is a pump system. This is the pump I can see, right? Now, this pump finder doesn't know where the pump is going to get utilized. He doesn't know which line is going to come in. What is the temperature for that line? He doesn't know. He has been given his data sheet for pressure, temperature, fluid. He doesn't know whether there is a valve. He doesn't know whether there is a support. Right? So what pump vendor does is that he follows a standard. For example, centrifugal pump vendor API 610. He follows the standard, right? What he says that this standard is giving me a set of table wherein the forces and moments are given. You can see here FX, FY, FZ, FR means resultant. And here MX, MY, MZ. So these are the three forces and three moments, which is the maximum permissible capacity for that pump. So pump vendor says that I will be taking these forces. For example, I have got 2-inch line and my pump is end suction top discharge. So this is my each end nozzle. So it is 890 newtons in X direction. I can take the force. And he designs his pump accordingly. Now, when it comes to you as a stress engineer, this becomes a binding on you that you cannot exert a force more than 890 newtons because of the pipe. The reason could be anything, weight, temperature, pressure, anything. There are various equipments and various standards for pump API 610, for tanks API 650, okay. For air fin coolers, it is API 661, for heaters API 560, okay. So various standards you need to follow. Then I need to even check the displacement. Now, because of temperature, what's going to happen? The pipe is going to get displaced. Now, this is one of the situation. This is the pipe rack, and onto this pipe rack means I was standing below and I just took the photo like this. These are the beams of the pipe rack. You can check this. This is a shoe. Now, the shoe has displaced. See, this is a pipe and this is a shoe which is welded to the pipe. And my finger is nothing but the beam below. Now, because of the huge displacement, what can happen? It can go here. Sometimes it can even slip for high temperature lines. What will happen if it slips? The insulation will get squeezed, but no accident, nothing will happen. The pipe will remain as it is. It will be like this, some extra stresses. Problem comes when you take a shutdown. When you take a shutdown, pipe wants to now go back because temperature has gone. When coming back, can it come back now? It cannot come back. And now the tremendous amount of force will try to shear this off. That can happen. So this is one of the failure which can you can see at the site. Fine, that's why the displacements. So what happens if you have large amount of displacement, more than say 75 to 100 millimeter, we go for a long shoe. Standard shoe length is 300 millimeter, but when you have 450 or 600 mm long shoe, we tell. Sometimes even off-centering of the shoe is done. Off-centering means I know that it's going to move like this. So initially itself, I keep the shoe like off-centered. So when it moves, it comes to center. But this is little bit risky. You have to have a confidence on your site team. If somebody reads the drawing in reverse way, and if he doesn't, then it will slip very early. Okay, that's why. And even sometimes you need to optimize the routes. Optimize the route in the sense, people think that if you give more number of bends to the system, it is more safe. Even the designers, those who have experience, what they do, I have the experience, I have seen the stress little bit, let's give more loops. But the problem is that nowadays, last 40-50 years, we have not seen much of a failure because of flexibility. Because lot of work has been done on flexibility in last 50 years, graphs and charts, and people started adding more and more flexibility in the piping system. The problem becomes the pipe vibrates if you give more number of loops. Very simple example, and if you can take it to your process very well, a typical example is a flare system, flare lines. Okay, the problem with the flare line is we always have the inlet. We have the inlet at temperature 100 degrees Celsius and the outlet somewhere 300 degrees Celsius. Design is given by the process engineer. Now, I don't know, they have their, because so many lines are connected to flare, one of them is 300 degree, so entire flare is given as 300 degree, and we as a stress engineer blindly follow the line list as a, you know, some Bible, like, you know, we need to follow it. Now, ridiculously, these lines do not have the insulations. So I don't know when the lines is going to touch 300, but whatever is the reason, if the line is reaching 300 degrees Celsius, and if you are going to analyze the entire system for 300, assuming it is the entire lifetime 300, then what happens? Your discharge piping always has something, these kind of roots. Your discharge pipes are rooted something like this with a 45, and this is a classic case of flow induced vibrations. When you have more number of bends, for that matter, this is my header. So you have given more number of loops and there is a discharge which is popping out high velocity fluid. So if the velocity exceeds certain limit, there will be a acoustic or flow induced vibration, and then these lines can vibrate and they will not fail because of temperature. Because in normal operation, the temperature will be probably near to ambient or sometimes 100 degree. Once in a blue moon, they will reach to 300. But because of the continuous vibrations, they can fail. It should be as straight as possible. One more misconcept a stress engineer has. If the stress in the system is 40%, I am very much happy. If the stress is 50, I am very much happy. See, we are not here to limit the stresses 10 degree or 10%, 20%, 30%. We have got a material which is non-living thing, which has been tested in the lab. We know the capacity, we have got the factor of safety from the code. So we should not mind, depending on the type of stresses, what should be the stress in the system. Even though 70% stress or 80% of the stress in some cases should be good enough. So we should know the factor of safeties. We should not aim that always the stress has to be low. Our design should be optimized. So okay. There are few accidents photographs I have. First is snaking of the line. Can you see this? This is the line which is being snaked. This is on pipe rack. You can see the shoe has come out. You can see the shoe has come out on the verge of coming out. Still, it is not failed. It is still in working condition. But for me, kind of a failure, right? If this projector does not show me the blue color at all. Now, supports sometimes do not work at site. You can see this. This is a classic case of lift off. Okay, and that is the reason we check in the stress system whether the supports are lifting or not. It can happen at site that the support really, now if the line has, you can see the support is welded to the line. When the line goes up, support also travels. Now this entire concrete structure is useless, as if there is no support. Bellows, expansion joints, they fail sometime. You can see this is one of the classic example of a bellow which we witness. Very delicate item. We will be having a separate session on the expansion joint itself. Okay. Sometimes the displacements of the pipes are huge. You can see some pictures. This entire flare line has, it has come down, fallen off. The supports are of no use. You can see it here. Some bends are squeezed. So this is the, you know, amount of energy a line has. So that is the reason we have to be careful. Plunge leak, one of the common problems, and for that we take a lot of efforts. We will be having a session on the flange leak as well. Flange leaks, if it is done in hydro test, if it is detected, very nice, we can take the action. But if it happens at a later stage and if the fluid is H2S or something like that, then it becomes a critical problem. Nozzle failures, that is also one of the problems, right? Nozzle can crack at the locally. The softwares which are beam element based cannot handle this situation. So you have to go with a software which is having the shell element or 2D or 3D elements, what we call as the FEA softwares. Okay. Nozzle failures, then the serious fire hazard. Sometimes you can have, if you haven't taken care of the flange leak properly and if the gas leaks and somebody just welds somewhere there, then the fire can be there. Even though he opts the certificate for all this welding and all, there could be a gas which is settled down, it could be a fire.